A very good afternoon to all the viewers. I, Dr. Brigadier Ashok Saxena, HOD Neonatology, Manipal Hospital, welcome you to this webinar on RH Isohumanized Baby. It was a very interesting case and very remarkable for a couple of things. One, that it happened. It happened in a multigravida. It happened in an booked and supervised pregnancy, and surprisingly and sadly, the place where the baby was born did not have the basic pediatric facilities. Now, without much ado, I would straight away go to the presentation part. The order of presentation would be the case presentation by Dr. Gyanam, who's our specialist in pediatrics, followed by the antenatal management of an RH isohumanized baby by Dr. Gitanjali Behel, who's our fetal medicine specialist. And finally, I would speak about the neonatal management, conclude and take all the questions if there are any. So over to Dr. Gyanam Mishra.
A very good afternoon, everyone. I am Dr. Gyanam Mishra, a specialist in pediatrics working in Manipal Hospital. So our was a newborn who presented to our ER on IPPR with bag and tube ventilation at 10 hours of life. The baby was a boy who was born on 15th of April 2020 at 8:23 a.m. at 38 weeks of gestation by normal vaginal delivery in a private nursing home at Jhajjar. The liquor was meconium stained. The baby cried at birth and the birth weight was 3.37 kg. The baby was vaccinated and injection vitamin K was given at birth. The baby was then referred to another center because of non-availability of pediatrician in that center, as the baby was a high risk and had RH isohumanization. The total serum bilirubin at 5 hours of life was 7 mg/dL. In the second center, he was intubated in view of poor breathing efforts and was referred to our hospital. The mother was a 35-year-old multigravida. The couple was married for 13 years. She was gravida 6, para 3 and had 2 abortions. Her first issue was MTP at 5.5 months of gestation for congenital anomaly, which was a neural tube defect. Her second issue was a spontaneous abortion at 2.5 months of gestation. Her third issue is an 8-year-old girl child who was born by normal vaginal delivery. There was no history of any jaundice in neonatal period and her blood group was B positive. Her fourth issue was a 6-year-old boy who was born by normal vaginal delivery. This boy had jaundice after birth. Exchange transfusion was done on day 4 and day 5 of life at a medical college in Rohtak. This baby developed kernicterus and later on developed dystonic cerebral palsy. Now this child is undergoing treatment at All India Institute of Medical Sciences. His blood group was also B positive. Our fifth issue was a 2.5-year-old girl who was born by a normal vaginal delivery. There was no jaundice in the neonatal period and her blood group was B negative. And the sixth issue was our patient. Her LMP was on 22nd of July 2019. Her EDD was 27th of April 2020. She was booked at a private hospital in Sonipat. She took folic acid in first trimester, was given tetanus toxoid, and iron and folic acid tablets and calcium were started from second trimester onwards. Ultrasound was done at 14 weeks and 19 weeks and were normal. Her quadruple marker was negative. In her investigations, hemoglobin was 10.6, RBS and TSH were normal. Her blood group was B negative, viral markers were normal. Indirect Coombs test were positive. In torch panel, IgM was negative and IgG was positive for CMV and rubella. In examination of our baby, in general examination, the heart rate was 110, CRT was less than 3 seconds, BP was 65 by 40, mean BP 50, respiratory rate was 40 per minute on ventilator, temperature was 36.4, icterus was present and severe pallor was present. In systemic examination, in chest, bilateral air entry was equal. In cardiovascular system, normal heart sounds with a hyperdynamic preordia, and there were no murmur. In abdominal examination, abdomen was soft, liver was 5 cm below the right subcostal margin, and spleen was also 5 cm below the costal margin. In CNS examination, the baby was lethargic and hypotonic. At admission, the RBS was 46 mg per deciliter, and other investigations were sent after 2 hours of intensive phototherapy and stabilization of the baby. The total lymphocyte count was 1 lakh, neutrophils were 9.8%, lymphocyte was 78.3%, hemoglobin was 6.4, and platelet was 1,20,000. CRP was negative. In venous blood gas, pH was 7.34, PCO2 was 34.7, PO2 was 41, bicarbonate was 18.6. Mother's blood group was B negative, mother's indirect Coombs test was positive, baby's blood group was B positive, and direct Coombs test was also positive. The total serum bilirubin was 9.6 at around 11 hours of birth. Direct bilirubin was 3.3. So our diagnosis was a 10-hour-old term boy, appropriate for gestational age, with severe anemia, jaundice, encephalopathy, hepatosplenomegaly due to RH isoimmunization. Initial treatment was started with mechanical ventilation with initial settings of SIMV mode, FiO2 of 100%, respiratory rate of 40, PIP of 20, and PEEP of 5. 10% dextrose was given in view of hypoglycemia. Intensive phototherapy was started. Packed RBC transfusion was started in view of severe anemia. IVIG first dose was given. Injection phenobarbital was started as the baby had subtle seizures. IV antibiotics, injection calcium gluconate, and IV fluids were also started. In subsequent investigations, the total serum bilirubin levels at 11 hours of life at the time of admission was 9.6, which gradually increased to 14.6 by 34 hours of life, and then gradually decreased to 6.8 by day 7 of life after management. The hemoglobin at the time of admission was 6.4, after which a packed RBC was given, which the hemoglobin transiently increased to 11 but again dropped down to 9.1 when again a packed RBC was given. The baby was discharged with a hemoglobin of 10.6 on day 8 of life. Initial total leukocyte count was 1 lakh, which was most probably because of the nucleated RBCs, which gradually decreased down to 7,230 by the time of discharge. The baby also had thrombocytopenia. Initial platelet count was 1,20,000, which was decreased to around 85,000 by the time of discharge. So plotting the total serum bilirubin levels on the Bhutanese chart, the bilirubin levels fall above 95th percentile, suggesting that this baby was at increased risk. The bilirubin levels were also plotted on the graph for guidelines of phototherapy in hospitalized infants. Our reference line was the middle line because this infant was at medium risk, 38 weeks of gestation, which with RH incompatibility. So definitely the bilirubin levels were above the reference line, suggesting this baby required phototherapy. We also plotted the bilirubin levels of the baby on the chart for guidelines of exchange transfusion in hospitalized infants. The bilirubin levels, our reference line was again the middle line, which is for medium risk, more than 38 weeks and risk factors. But the bilirubin levels in our case did not reach the middle line. Other investigations that we did were a peripheral smear in which RBCs were normocytic normochromic, WBCs were within normal range, platelets were less, and no abnormal cells were seen. Blood culture was showed no growth. Urine RM was also within normal limits. In LFT, SGOT was 107, SGPT was 38, alkaline phosphatase was 198, and albumin was 3.4, TSH was 12.2. The chest X-ray was also within normal limits. During the course of stay, the sensorium of the baby improved by 30 hours of life and there were no further seizures. We were able to wean off the baby from mechanical ventilator by 60 hours of life. Intensive phototherapy was given for 5 days. During intensive phototherapy, the baby had high colored urine, which the color turned out to be normal after discontinuing phototherapy after 24 hours. Packed RBC transfusion was given at 16 hours of life and then again at 42 hours of life. We gave 2 doses of IVIG, one at admission and one at 38 hours of life. Phenobarbital was given for a total of 7 days. IV antibiotics were given for 7 days. Injection calcium gluconate for 72 hours. And tube feeding was initiated on day 3 of life and gradually increased to full feeds. The baby was finally discharged on exclusive breastfeeding. So this is the picture of the phototherapy, the baby who is getting phototherapy, intensive phototherapy. So the baby came for follow-up at 2 months of age. The baby had was on exclusive breastfeeding and was vaccinated at 1.5 months of age. The urine and stool color were normal. In anthropometry, weight was 4.45 kg and all length and head circumference were within normal limits. Also on examination, the spleen and liver had also regressed in size. In neurodevelopmental examination, according to the mother, the baby turns the head towards sound and has developed social smile. The baby had a normal amiltacin with normal passive tone, normal head control, and there was no obligate ATNR. The hemoglobin was 9.5, total serum bilirubin was 0.4, OAE was normal and Bera is planned at 3 months of age. Currently, the baby is on exclusive breastfeeding, vitamin B3, D3, and iron drops. So here is the picture of our little patient with this mother. Thank you.
Now I would request Dr. Gitanjali, our fetal medicine expert, to give her presentation on antenatal management, which we think is absolutely important to ensure that that such cases are firstly prevented. That means the solution lies in prevention of RH isomerization. Secondly, to diagnose early and, if possible, to treat while in utero, to plan delivery. There are many aspects to it. I think she would be the best person to talk about it. So over to Dr. Gitanjali.
So when a RH negative mother carries a RH positive fetus, so due to fetal maternal hemorrhage, few of the RBC, fetal RBC, they can cross the placenta and they reach into the maternal circulation. And they can stimulate the immune system of the mother. So immune system will start forming antibodies. These antibodies, they can cross the placenta and enter into the fetal circulation. They will cover the fetal RBCs, and these antibody coated RBCs, then they will remove by the fetal reticular endothelial system by the process of hemolysis. So this is actually the natural course of disease of RH isomerization. So because of this hemolysis, there will be fetal anemia and hypoxia. So compensatory mechanism will start working. There will be extramedullary erythropoiesis. So it will lead to hepatosplenomegaly and hepatic dysfunction, hypoproteinemia. Ultimately, there will be collection of fluid in the different body cavities like pleural effusion, pericardial effusion, ascites and high drops. And if it will not get correct, then there are chances of intrauterine fetal demise or severe hemolytic disease of newborn, like in our case. So this is actually, I want to share obstetrical history of this mother. She is actually para 4, life 4, A2, and according to her, she has received injection NTD in all her pregnancies. So the first one was termination of pregnancy at 5.5 months of gestation due to neurotube defect. Second one, again, it was spontaneous abortion. And because she received injection NTD, actually it is a good policy. We should prescribe injection NTD after abortion, ectopic pregnancy, or any other antenatal invasive procedure. So liberal use of injection NTD is the reason for declining trend of RH isomerization nowadays. Third one was normal pregnancy. The fourth one, actually, now this is very important. In fourth pregnancy, the baby was showing the features of hemolytic disease. and received transfusion also, developed Connectress and later Distoning CP. So that means it is actually a isoimmunized pregnancy, developed complications. So question may raise, although she has received injection antibody in previous pregnancy, but now again this pregnancy is affected pregnancy. The reason could be a large fetal maternal hemorrhage, which may not get neutralized by the standard dose of injection antibody. The next one, again, it is actually a unaffected pregnancy. So reason behind this is actually the zygosity of the father, whether the father is homozygous or heterozygous. Because in homozygous father, all the children will be Rh positive. While in the heterozygous father, few of the children may be Rh negative. So it is true for our case. The female, we have noted that the blood group of this female was Rh negative. So that was the reason of escape. Now sixth pregnancy, the case which we are discussing here, again showing the features of hemolytic disease. So now actually it is very sad. Patient is already having a history of unaffected baby. Again, she was not managed well in her antenatal period. So all these complications were preventable, but because of lack of that obstetrical care, she developed all these things repeatedly. So actually now how to manage Rh negative pregnancy? So whenever a patient comes to us in her Rh negative mother, in her first antenatal visit only, we should advise her indirect womb test irrespective of her parity, whether she is primary gravida or a multi who has received injection antibody. So we should advise ICT if it is negative and husband is positive. In that case, we should follow up the pregnancy. At 28 weeks, we should administer injection antibody. And after delivery, we should check the blood group of the baby and direct home test should be done. If the baby blood group is Rh positive and DCT is negative, we should advise injection antibody. So this is the management of Rh negative non-immunized pregnancy. What if we are getting indirect womb test positive? So if the indirect womb test is positive, always see the titer again. So titer, if it is actually sometimes what happened in the titer, if we are getting in a low like 1:1 or 1:2 titer, in that case always confirm again whether it is truly positive or not. If it is ICT positive, that means it is a isoimmunized pregnancy and we have to manage it accordingly. So what is the aim of management in an Rh isoimmunized pregnancy? The aim is we have to detect fetal anemia as soon as possible, and if there is fetal anemia, we have to treat that. So this is a basic aim for treatment of Rh isoimmunized pregnancy. So these are the actually absolute method of monitoring. Nowadays we are not using that. The first one is actually serial ICT titer estimation. Especially in the first immunized pregnancy, we were doing that, but nowadays this is not in use. The second one is Lilly's method, spectrophotometric analysis of amniotic fluid bilirubin. It is an invasive test and now totally obsolete. Because we have a, so nowadays test of choice for monitoring a Rh isoimmunized pregnancy is middle cerebral artery Doppler. So why so? Because it is a non-invasive method and ultrasound is easily accessible. But why middle cerebral artery Doppler? So for this we should understand the physiological response of fetal anemia. So whenever there is fetal anemia, there will be decrease in the blood viscosity and there will be increase in the stroke volume. It will lead to increase in the cardiac output. Ultimately, there will be increase in the blood flow and the blood velocity in all the blood vessels of the body. So then why we are choosing only middle cerebral artery, not any other vessel? So the answer is because it is vessel of choice, because we could be sample at zero insonation angle. So what is actually, it is ultrasound physics. Whenever we want to estimate the blood velocity of any blood vessel, the ultrasound beam should be parallel to the blood flow. If it will be on any other angle or perpendicular, we could not get the velocity exact measurement we could not get. So here we can see this is actually ultrasound beam path. This is actually flow direction. This is circle of Willis, middle cerebral artery, right and left middle cerebral artery. So here we can see the blood flow direction is actually parallel to the ultrasound beam. And we can see here SV angle. The angle of insulation is zero. So this is a perfect position and we will get the correct measurement of velocity because our further estimation is totally depend on the velocity value. So for example, if I want to measure this vessel velocity, so it will not be possible because now ultrasound blood is flowing in this vessel also, but the ultrasound beam path is actually in this way and blood is flowing perpendicular to this insulation. So this is actually 90 degree insulation. We will get the velocity zero if we will monitor in this stage. So this is the reason. Other reason is actually MCA vessel is sensitive to effect of hypoxia and we can detect fetal anemia in condition other than the RH immunization, where the hemolysis is the cause for fetal anemia. But like in parvovirus B19 infection or CAL sensitization, where bone marrow suppression is a cause, so it will cause fetal anemia. So definitely it will increase the velocity. But if we want to do estimation according to Lilly's method, so that is actually analyze the amniotic fluid bilirubin, which will only be raised in condition where hemolysis will be there. So this is the reason why this is test of choice. So MCA Doppler normally we usually interpret in the multiple of median. So multiple of median means the test result how much there is deviation from the median. So when the value of MCA is 1.5 or more than that, equivalent to 1.5 or more than that, it is suggestive of severe, moderate to severe fetal anemia. So this is a graph plotted taken from the Marin et al. And it is a graph where MCA peak velocity is actually this graph plotted against the gestational age in weeks. And we are able to see here there are four zones A, B, C, and D. So A, what is the meaning of A zone? A zone means MCA PSV value is equivalent to 1.5 or more than that. So that means it is a danger zone and intervention is required, whether it is in form of intrauterine transfusion or delivery. The second is B zone. B zone means it is a zone of which is showing mild anemia. Mild anemia means MCA Doppler, MCA PSV value is in between 1.29 to 1.5. So whenever we are getting higher value of MCA PSV, then always there should be a practice to see the other ultrasound features of fetal anemia that I will discuss later. So whenever we are getting our MCA PSV in this zone, we should be very careful and monitoring can be done in 5 to 7 days. But additionally, if we are getting any other ultrasound features of fetal anemia, we can increase the frequency accordingly. C and D zone is comparatively safer zone. We can monitor it by 2 to 4 weekly. So this is the main protocol. Now this is actually a reference chart which is showing MCA PSV value according to gestation. So on rough estimation, what is the point? We can see that if the MCA PSV is more than twice the period of gestation in weeks, then it is suggestive of severe anemia. So that we can take a rough idea about that. For example, here 18 weeks gestation, the value is 36, that is almost double. At 20 weeks, the value is around 39.5. So we can get the idea that the baby is having severe anemia. So we have to do, we have to intervene. One more special thing here. Actually, MCA, when to start the MCA PSV surveillance in a case of RH isomerized pregnancy. So usually we start it by 18 weeks only. So what is the reason? Reason is actually the fetal reticuloendothelial system usually get mature by 18 to 20 weeks only. And that is the, before that, this fetus will not show the fetal anemia will not develop before this gestation. So this is the reason why we usually start cervicals only after only at 18 weeks onward. So I will just want to talk about the other ultrasound features which are such as which can be suggestive of fetal anemia. So always see, always have the practice if we are getting MCA Doppler on the higher side, because sometimes what happens if we are applying more probe pressure or if we are taking MCA Doppler in the fetal activity phase, we can get higher value of the MCA-PSP. Whether it is actually exact value or it is just because of some other reason, we should see whether any other ultrasound feature of anemia is present or not. For example, here we can see this is the spleen. We can measure the splenic size and liver size, and we can compare it with the reference chart available for gestational age. This is the area. Actually, it is prenasal thickness. If it is more than 5 mm, that is actually suggestive of subcutaneous edema. We should see whether there is any cardiomegaly or pericardial effusion, whether tricuspid regurgitation is present or not, because it is a sensitive indicator for development of ascites and hydrops. So here we can see cardiomegaly along with the pericardial effusion. This is actually ascites. This is a picture showing gross ascites. So all these are features of fetal anemia in ultrasound. Additionally, we should see the placental thickness and amount of ligand, because polyhydramnios and placentomegaly, they are another features of fetal anemia, ultrasound features of fetal anemia. So these were the method of surveillance. Now what if we are getting MCA-PSC more than 1.5 mm and it is actually moderate to severe anemia, there is a requirement of intervention. Intervention could be in term of intrauterine blood transfusion or delivery. So how to decide? So major deciding factor is the gestational age. For example, if I'm getting this finding at 34 weeks or 35 weeks, in that case, I would like to go with the delivery. I will give steroid cover and I will deliver the baby and I will transfuse the blood in the neonatal period. But similarly, if I am getting this finding at 28 weeks only, then I would like to go in favor of intrauterine blood transfusion, because baby is extremely premature. I cannot impose iatrogenic prematurity and related complication additional to the fetal anemia. Second, when there are certain rules for intrauterine blood transfusion. For example, if the fetal anemia develops in between 18 to 26 weeks, the hematocrit, we will transfuse the blood when the hematocrit will be less than 25. While more than 26 weeks, the criteria is if the hematocrit value is less than 30 weeks. And there should be a habit of correction of anemia correctly, completely. Ideally, post-transfusion hematocrit should be in between 45 to 50, because under correction will require more frequent transfusion and related risk. And actually, this is the whenever we want fetal transfusion at an earlier gestation age, usually it will carry poor prognosis. That means the fetus develop very severe disease in very early gestation age. So these are the features, and there are various routes for intrauterine transfusion. I will not go much in detail. This was actually antenatal monitoring plan and management for cases of RHI immunization. So I will thank you, and I will thank you.
Anjali has spoken about something very, very simple, that it is caused by transplacental passage of maternal antibodies against paternal RH antigen of the fetus or fetal RBCs. We all know that. And how does it happen? It happens because of fetomaternal hemorrhages. 90% of these RH isomerized or RH isomerization cases are caused by the D antigen, the rest having been caused by the C and the E antigen. I always wonder as to what is the incidence of RH negative blood group in our country. It is about 5 to 6%. In Japan, you rarely find an RH negative person, while in America, it is about 14%. So I think we need to know the epidemiology. And as Gitanjali told all of us, that some of the fathers are heterozygous, and then the baby can be RS negative, as was one of the babies in our case. So these babies obviously would escape affection despite the mother being RH isomerized. So what we estimate is that the chances of RH incompatibility setting being discovered in a normal risk antenatal OPD should be around 3 to 4%. So 3 to 4% of your patients of obstetricians in a normal antenatal OPD would have an RH negative mother with a RS positive husband. And for reasons that we would perhaps delineate subsequently, only 5% of the at-risk mothers have neonates with significant hemolytic disease. Now, pathogenesis, a little bit about it. Now, the fetal-maternal hemorrhages, they occur throughout the pregnancy. We must understand that. It's 3% in first trimester, 12% in second trimester, and 46% in third trimester. So that's why we recommend NTD to be given after abortion or after CVS, chorionic villi sampling or amniocentesis, or after 28 weeks. And so that's why we recommend the NTD administration in between as well. But yes, the chances keep on increasing as the pregnancy advances. Now, the initial antibody is IgM to begin with, which does not cross placenta. And the IgG antibody, which crosses the placenta, takes 6 months to be synthesized. That's how the first baby escapes from getting affected. Now, sensitization can be, as I said, can be caused by abortion, by ectopic pregnancy, by abdominal trauma, chorionic villi sampling, amniocentesis, version, which are so very rare, fortunately, so very rare now, and certain things which make fetal-maternal hemorrhages more likely at the time of delivery. So what affects the severity of these hemorrhages? Volume of fetal-maternal hemorrhages, as the drama unfolded in our case, despite administration of NTD, as Gitanjali told you, after every abortion or MTP or delivery, the mother still had RH isomerization and the baby was affected. So whenever the volume is high, you may have to give a higher dosage of NTD. So that may prevent the RH sensitization of the mother. There are other factors which affect immunogenicity of antigens, for example, T antigen is more immunogenic. Maternal response to RH antigen varies. So some mothers somehow form antibodies more readily and more vigorously. The type of antibodies I just spoke about, that is the IgG antibodies which cross and not the IgM antibody. That's how the first pregnancy usually escapes from RH sensitization. The avian compatibilities is somehow protective against RH isomerization, because the moment the cells cross, the fetal cells cross over to the maternal circulation, they are quickly destroyed and there is little time for RH sensitization. The gravida status, the smaller the family size, the less the chances of sensitization. So our mother obviously was cis gravida, so that was another factor that perhaps affected the increased the chances of the baby getting affected. The clinical features, the severity may be mild with baby just needing conventional phototherapy, but the classical RH isomerization is what, when it is moderate, where babies require intensive phototherapy with possible exchange transfusion. This is the typical profile that we all are familiar with. But the most dreaded and most dire complication of RH isomerization is this hydroxyspiralis needing resuscitation, abdominal paracentesis, bilateral pleural tap with IPPR and DR itself. And sometimes the laryngeal edema is so severe that you have to negotiate a very small size endotracheal tube. And Kitanjali, in fact, told us why, what is the pathogenesis of all the clinical features. The hemolysis causes anemia, which may be immediate, maybe in fact, maybe in utero, may develop after, soon after birth, or maybe delayed. It may take place after several weeks after the baby is born. Elevated bilirubin, of course, this is what concerns most of us, because it's the bilirubin that is neurotoxic. And if you remember, the sibling of the baby is had conicterus and is handicapped. He can't even walk. So this is the, to my mind, if you ask me, hydrophytalis is not so common, but elevated bilirubin causing conicterus is something that all the pediatricians and neonatologists dread the most. Extramedullary hematopoiesis, which causes hepatic splenomegaly. It also results in pressure on the intrahepatic arteries, which result in hepatocellular dysfunction. Cardiac failure, which perhaps our baby had to begin with. Hepatocellular dysfunction, which I just spoke about because of the extramedullary hematopoiesis, the cardiac failure, and maybe chronic hypoxia. Hydrophytalis, Gitanjali just told us about. The initial assessment, the early features of hydrophytalis may be placental thickening, a double wall bowel sign in the ultrasound, and the hepatic splenomegaly. Of course, once the baby has severe hydrophytalis, you would have the nuchal, the subcutaneous edema, the ascites, the pleural effusions, the pericardial effusions, etc. Thrombocytopenia. Now, this is poorly understood as to why the baby has thrombocytopenia. Is it because of decreased production? Is it antibody mediated? Or is it because of hypersplenism? We do not know much about it. Fetal hyperinsulinism is well known and results in hypoglycemia and delayed lung maturity. So we should know, that's why Gitanjali talked about the delivery. So before you deliver at 35 weeks in a severely affected baby, I would rather have the baby being given intrauterine transfusion and antenatal corticosteroids, and then we would have the baby delivered. But the most dreaded complication is bilirubin encephalopathy. Now, we all know that the risk of bilirubin encephalopathy, in addition to the bilirubin levels, is aggravated by low albumin, which decreases the bilirubin binding, and the unconjugated bilirubin crosses the blood-brain barrier more readily, prematurity, and any kind of sickness. I won't go into details. Investigations are very simple. Complete blood count, what we did, blood probe, DCT, peripheral blood smear. Somehow, I think the a few things are missed in the peripheral blood smear. This happens in clinical practice. You never get a copybook picture in your, when you are practicing. If you get it, you are very, very lucky. Serum bilirubin. I would talk about the fact that we had a direct positive bilirubin later. Now, management. Now, this is the scenario that all of us are most, wouldn't like it to happen. A neonate requiring delivery room resuscitation as the baby has hydrophytalis. Such babies, as I said, require not only intubation, they require abdominal paracentesis, thoracocentesis, and may require soda bicarb, subsequently fluid management, very, very careful fluid management. So those cases are very, very difficult to manage, of course. A very severe anemia where the HbA has dropped to 2 to 4 grams may require partial exchange transfusion with pegged RBCs. So one of the, indication for exchange or partial exchange is the very, very severe anemia, because there perhaps giving pegged RBCs may precipitate congestive cardiac failure. So this is one of the indications for partial exchange transfusion. Yes, now this is what our talk is all about. If you recall, our initial bilirubin levels were very, very high. And perhaps if we had not given intensive phototherapy, the baby would have, in fact, 14.6 was, if I can see, was just 2 milligrams below the exchange line, and it was still rising, and we know that peaks around 48 hours or so, and we could avert that and we could bring the bilirubin down is because of intensive phototherapy. So what it is, I'll talk about in some detail. So intensive phototherapy, if I may say so, has changed the complete management of RH isomerization. I still recall when I read 1986 Gordon Avery edition. So it was cod bilirubin of 5 milligrams, cod HB of 10 grams per deciliter, reticulocyte 15%, and blah, blah, blah. This has all changed. Now there is only one indication for exchange transfusion, and that is the bilirubin approach, the levels at which exchange transfusion is indicated. First, you decide as to which risk graph does the baby belong to, as Dr. Gyanam just showed you so very, very well. And once you see that, you do exchange, or you perform exchange only if you think that the levels are reaching where an exchange transfusion may be indicated as per the those AAP graphs. So how we manage this RH isomerized pregnancy? We manage jaundice with intensive phototherapy, and we manage anemia with packed cell transfusion. It is said, once the bilirubin is within 2 to 3 milligrams of exchange, you give IVIG. The dose is 0.5 to 1 gram. Some people say one dose is enough. Some people say you give 2 dosages. We give 2 dosages to our baby. And lastly, double volume exchange transfusion. Now, this may be a very, very rare event. It is estimated in US, the incidence of DVET is about 3 per lakh pregnancies. It's that rare. So that means if you manage your babies well, they should not require double volume exchange transfusion. This is a graph that Gyanam showed you. And now this is the how to make, I think this is something very close to my heart. This is what I do normally. We start immediately. We do not wait. I go there myself. We start phototherapy immediately. It's called the crash cart approach. We start all special blue. We are very clear about it. We don't use, because you've got to bring down the bilirubin. And especially, is there a saturation point? There may be some saturation point for formation of the configurational isomers like 4Z15E, but there is no saturation point for the structural isomer, that is bilirubin. So the more dose you give, the more bilirubin is formed, and the more rapidly it falls. So we use, classically we use 2 undersurface phototherapy with the Billy blankets. We put 6 LEDs on the top, and we cover the baby with a reflecting surface. We also at times remove the diaper for some time, and that is done, absolutely done. So you ensure maximum area coverage by using double surface phototherapy, make the nappy as small as possible, and remove it for some time if it is approaching dangerous levels. We, of course, as I said, we use 6 from top and 2 from below. Decrease the distance as much as you can. A direction of light should be perpendicular to the incubator walls. And we do not interrupt phototherapy if bilirubin is very, very high. And as I said, we line the bassinet with reflecting material. A few things. I think if you want to make your hospital phototherapy effective, see that we check it with a flux meter. Our maintenance staff comes and checks it at periodic interval. Clean the plexiglass shield and the tube lights, because dust accumulates and somehow decrease the reflectance or the transmission of the flux. How much can you bring it down? Hansen reported about 10 to 11 milligrams fall in 2 to 3 hours. And we've had fall of 10 milligrams in 4 hours. And the saying is, the higher the bilirubin and the higher the dose of phototherapy, the more rapid the decline. So you can hope to bring down very, very dramatically. Other agents. Now, this baby had, as Dr. Gyanam brought out, had subtle seizures. Most likely, the bilirubin never were even close distance to 20. It was very, very. In fact, when the baby came, baby's levels were 7 milligrams. So most likely, it was the hypoxia that the baby had, which resulted in. But one thing good it did was that phenobarbital must have led to rapid conjugation, and One thing about phenobarbital is it is not useful at all in first 48 hours. So it cannot bring down a bilirubin which is high. But once you're given phototherapy, it may, after a couple of days, may prevent subsequent resurgence of bilirubin. The heme oxygenase inhibitors like tinproporfyrin have been spoken about since 1988 but never used, because maybe because of the advent of intensive phototherapy, clofibrate and orlistat, which prevent the absorption. And DBT, as I said, if the phototherapy fails. And these are the levels. So if you see at 34 hours, 14.6 was, when was it 14.6?
34 hours.
34 hours. Now, if it was 34 hours at 34 hours would be somewhere here. And the line for exchange would have been around 16.5 or 17. So we were just 2 milligrams short of it. And we did not allow it to rise. And the urine was very dark yellow. And the moment we stopped phototherapy, within 24 hours of it, it came down. The urine color became normal. Now, why was bilirubin had dead positive? Why was it dead positive also? Elicitable, and the levels went up. The causes could be many. One could be cardiac failure with hepatic congestion, which results in hepatocellular dysfunction, which I spoke about. The extramedullary hematopoiesis, which might have compressed the intrahepatic arteries and led to hepatocellular dysfunction. But to my mind, I am very clear that it was a measurement of photoisomers, the limirubin, the 4Z15E bilirubin, which were measured as direct bilirubin, because after stopping phototherapy, the urine color declined. It became almost normal. And as the follow-up revealed that the baby has no evidence of conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. Prevention, Dr. Gitanji spoke about, we give NTD 300 microgram to the RH negative mother within 72 hours after delivery of RH positive neonate. We also give it after every abortion, after every abdominal trauma, ectopic pregnancy, amniocentesis. Larger than 10 ml fetal-maternal hemorrhages may require higher dose. So when do you expect larger fetal-maternal hemorrhages, antepartum hemorrhage, especially the neonate is anemic, there has been maternal manual removal of placenta, there you may have to give higher dosage. Another dose at 28 to 32 weeks is also recommended, and it avoids the, or it kind of brings down the incidence of sensitization even further, avoiding version, manual separation of placenta, and small family size are other measures which can prevent or decrease the incidence of this issue or this problem. Thank you very much. So now if there are any questions, I'll take all the questions which concern the neonate, and Dr. Gitanjali is available if you want to ask her anything concerning the antenatal management. She's there to answer those questions. And Dr. Gyanam, of course, would answer anything regarding the presentation part. Cool. Blood transfusion on day one on. Where is it? Next button. Okay. Now, firstly, we did give packed cell transfusion on day one itself. So that is not that we did not give blood transfusion. Now, IVIG is something that you are absolutely right. NF guidelines are, I don't think I would follow NF guidelines at my level. We follow the standard text. So you don't have to give, there was no indication. If you meant blood transfusion, we gave blood transfusion on within, let's say, 6 hours of arrival. So we did give blood transfusion, packed cell transfusion. In fact, we did give one, we gave two. So we did give. So, and IVIG, of course, is something which is indicated by most of the standard tests. So we gave it. So we had a very interesting case, which was, as I said, is remarkable because it happened in today's scenario. It happened in a booked and supervised pregnancy. It happened in a multigravida, and it was a little ironic that despite having been supervised by a good obstetrician, she had to deliver the baby in a center where there were hardly any pediatric facilities. Thank you very much for your viewership. Thank you.